to the fourth in our series of webinars with GoAbroad.com, and this is our fourth topic of discussion, which is planning ahead for the demand of English teachers post-coronavirus. My name is Rosie Mansfield and I'm Managing Director of Premier TEFL, and you're very, very welcome today to this topic discussion with my very special guests. I'm joined by some experts in application and recruitment for teaching English abroad, and we're very lucky now to get some insight today into all of the preparation that you need to do now to make sure that you can be one of the first to go abroad whenever the restrictions lift and we can get travelling again. So first, I'm going to ask my colleagues to introduce themselves today. Sandra, why don't you kick us off?
Hi, I'm Sandra, and I'm the operations manager here at Premier TEFL. So as soon as someone books on one of our courses or on our internship programs, I'm the one who's in contact. So you get a friendly phone call from me, and I'll be your best friend from then on. I'm also in touch, and I'm the link with all our overseas partners. So I'm in regular contact with them, see if there's any updates on a regular basis. Anyway, now with the situation that we have globally, I'm in touch with them on a weekly basis to see if there's any news and updates. So, that's what I'm here for.
Monse?
Yes, so thank you so much, Rosie, for inviting me today. And my name is Monse Aljama. I am based in Spain, and currently I am an internships director in Spain for those who want to come to Spain and teach in different schools. So mainly my task is to be in contact with schools and interns so I can place them for a year practice. So thank you.
And Sandra, in terms of the countries that you're in touch with at this time in the weekly basis, there's a whole bunch of people that you're talking to around the world. Tell us some of the destinations that you're currently talking to.
Yeah, so basically I'm linked with all partners across the globe, mainly in Asia. That's where most of our internship programs run. South America as well, Argentina, and then we have a couple of summer camps in Europe as well.
So we're talking Vietnam, Thailand. Yeah. Myanmar, Cambodia, yeah, lots and lots. So it's wonderful because for the folks watching at home, they're going to get a real flavour of what the situation is currently like abroad and all the changes and the nuances that we're going to feel now once we can begin to travel after restrictions lift, which is super. So tell me this, Sandra, from talking to our partners abroad, is there a demand for teachers at the minute?
There is, definitely. So all our partners at the moment, I'm really happy to say that, can confirm that all programs are going ahead as planned, or they're planning to go ahead for now. The restrictions seem to loosen up in a lot of countries, especially in Asia. Some countries are even back to school. Most of them have set dates now for July that school terms start again. So that's fantastic news. At the moment, obviously, as everyone knows, international travel is a big problem. I got an update yesterday. For most countries, it seems that in July that there will be set rules. Thailand tried a few things. They came up with that they wanted people to come with a negative test, but they got rid of that idea really, really quickly because obviously that's not possible. Then there's the talk about a two-week quarantine program, and all our partners are trying to accommodate that at the moment, trying to make arrangements for if these regulations are going to be put in place, which I think, or my personal feeling is that there will have to be international rules and regulations for international travel. So because sometimes you have to go from one country to the other to arrive at your destination. So I can imagine that a two-week quarantine might be a thing, but not to worry, they're all prepared for that and they're all happy to cater for that when people come to the country.
That's right. And for anybody who's following our series, in the last episode, we were joined by one of our partners, Leila, in Thailand. And she also spoke a bit about the plan to launch in July and how the school semester had been pushed out. And they're really working hard to make those accommodations for people. They're organising the quarantine hotel and they're setting up everything that they can to make it a smooth transition for as many people as possible who are able to travel at that time. I guess the one thing we really don't know at the minute is when travel restrictions for international travel from certain countries will be lifted. And that all depends on the previous weeks and the results that come before that. So from that perspective, we don't have anything in concrete, but today's topic and today's discussion is all about what can you be doing from home now to make sure that you have all of your items organized, and so that when you're ready to travel, that you're not caught saying, oh, I need an extra 2 or 3 weeks to get this piece of paperwork done, or my local embassy isn't ready to take my application. Yeah. And it's a good time for us to talk about this and get it in people's minds. So I'm excited to do this conversation today. Anse, in Spain, are some of the schools starting to reopen now? What's your experience?
Okay, so for starters, I'll have to say that there is definitely, and there has been, a huge demand in Spain for English teachers. So obviously, we're going through a hiccup at the moment, but we're pretty sure that that demand is going to carry on through next year as well. So at the moment, schools are closed, but they are working towards September and reopening. Obviously, there is still loads of things that the government has to implement, and there's loads of rules that are still not clear. But from the contact that I have with all these schools and directors from the schools, is that they are just waiting to hear exactly how do they have to reopen so they can plan again for next year. And that will be the point when they will look into hiring all these native teachers again. So we are very positive that from September, October, they are going to want to have native teachers in their school again. Within the next couple of months, we will see that impact in demand. So people will have to start preparing right now and training themselves right now, so they are ready for when that demand comes in, then they can apply for the positions.
That's it. And I was so surprised when I talked to the recruiters in episode 3 of this series about how the recruiters for many Southeast Asian countries, and including Poland, they're still recruiting and interviewing people all the time. And so I suppose when I had that conversation, and I was so excited by the opportunity that is still there for people who are keen to travel as soon as possible, that this conversation had to be the next one to be had, which is how do we help people prepare and get organized? Because in any case, if you're moving continent for a job, then there's lots of little tick boxes you have to do, lots of organization to be done. And the great thing about going with an organization is that they help you prepare for all that, which is what we're here for. But with the changes from the pandemic, then we need to be extra supportive for people who are keen to teach English abroad. And so that's why we're going to really get into the meat and bones of it now and start looking at what documentation do people need to prepare, how long might it take in the current circumstances, and extra little pieces that people can be doing to get themselves ready. Now, if you're at home watching this and thinking, oh, there's actually jobs available in TEFL, there's recruitment happening, where can I start to look for this? Have a look at some of the dedicated TEFL job websites like TEFL.com, ESLBase.com, ESLCafe.com. There's a ton of websites and job boards out there from all types of different TEFL providers that have postings from schools around the world. So you can be browsing these opportunities, finding matches for your personality and your background, and start preparing some application documents. So let's get into it. Okay, and I have a list here of things so that we don't forget anything. Now, Sandra, this is your area of expertise, so I might come to you first on this, okay? When we're thinking about applying for a TEFL job, one of the first things we look at completing would be an application form or a CV or a resume plus the cover letter, okay? Talk to us about what questions people should expect to answer during an application form for a TEFL job or internship.
Yeah, so usually it starts with all your personal information. That's obviously important for everyone to have. And then it depends. Some countries want more information. Some rely on the personal contact that will be established later and interview the people straight away. But you can expect that you ask to write something about your motivation for applying for the country. So that might be something you want to give some thought of now and prepare what you might want to say there. And then they want to know maybe the age preference, the group that you want to teach, and things like that will come up in the application form. We have a lot of partners that like a little video in advance. So if you think about that now, it might be frightening to record yourself, but it's just a 60-second, 90-second little clip that you make of yourself where you talk about your motivation, talk a little bit about yourself and your experience. Obviously, that's very important for them to know as well. And yeah, just come across as friendly as you can and smiley and motivated, because it's, after all, the first impression that you make on our part.
That's what I was going to say. This is your chance to do a wonderful first impression. And when they see your enthusiasm, because sometimes it's hard to get all of your energy and enthusiasm down in words on a written application form. But if you've been offered the opportunity to send an intro video, then that is such a great opportunity to really put across your emotion, your excitement, your passion for this opportunity. And it can really help the employer see whether you would be somebody to take to the next stage of application. So you're right, putting thought into that is really good. And on our application forms, I know there's a sample video that people can watch and they can see other past sort of A star applicants whenever they've submitted their video, which is helpful. But I'm sure on YouTube, I'm sure people would find samples there too. And just in terms of intro videos or demo videos, for people, whilst we're talking about traveling internationally now, people also may want to travel internationally but still keep teaching English online, which is a huge trend at the minute. And when you're applying for jobs online, often you must prepare a demo video, a short lesson. So recording yourself is a normal sort of scenario now in job applications in TEFL, and it's a great chance. So you've got to use that opportunity to your maximum capacity. Okay, great stuff. Now, this might sound like a silly thing, but the importance of having a TEFL certificate in the job application process. Monse, when you're handling somebody for a job in Spain, talk to me about the importance of having the TEFL certificate completed.
To have the TEFL certificate is highly important because all schools are going to ask for the certificate. So this is one of the main things that we are going to be asking for when someone applies for a job or for an internship in Spain. So obviously, like referring to what you said before in the video, showing motivation and, you know, showing that you really want this opportunity is very important, but they see the TEFL certificate as proof of that training that obviously they want you to have in order to be able to teach their students. So it is very important that you should have that certificate because that's imperative if you want to apply for the job.
It is. And like you say, it's tied directly to your motivation and your dedication. You know,
sure.
We don't apply for an engineering job and then say, I'll do an engineering degree if you say you'll hire me. It doesn't really work like that. So you've definitely got to show your commitment to this field first. Before you're going to be taken seriously by employers.
Yeah, they want to know that you just don't come over just because you want to, you know, this life in Spain of sunshine. They want to know that you actually are motivated to do it and that you have some passion to do it. And obviously your training shows that.
It's true. It's so true. And in terms of, and this is a point where a lot of people are confused about TEFL, okay? So the need to have a degree certificate. Sandra, do you need to be degree qualified to get a job or an internship teaching English?
Yeah, you do. For most countries, or for a lot of countries in Asia, it's necessary to have a degree, like China and Thailand and Vietnam as well. For our programs as well, they expect the degree for that in Myanmar and in Argentina as well. So it's okay, like if you know that you have it, if you have it already and if you have pocketed it, it's fine, that's super. You have the certificate there, so you can submit it. It's good to know when you would be able to get your degree certificate, especially in these times. So it would be good to get in touch with the admissions office of your university or college if you're due to graduate this year to actually really know when you have it. You need it definitely 4 to 5 weeks before you travel because arrangements have to be made, especially for visa purposes, sometimes you will need it for a legalization process. So it's really, really important to know when you can get it. At the time you apply with us, for example, if you're still in education or you know you get it in the next few weeks or in a month's time, it's okay to submit a transcript for the time being. But we need to know a date as well when your certificate will be issued.
Mm-hmm. And especially now with colleges being closed at the minute, It's difficult to know when graduation might happen for 2020 students. So it's good to start to ask those questions of your university and find out, when might I get my actual degree certificate? Mm-hmm. And that will help you know, I might need to plan 8 weeks in advance of that for any travel. You know, if you're not going to get your official degree certificate and you're planning to teach in a country where a degree is required, then you need to make sure your timeline adds up for that. Now, there are plenty of countries where you can teach English without having a degree. So if you haven't been to third level education, then there are countries that are suited to you, or you may decide to teach English online and live abroad, but there's still lots of options for non-degree holders. So the best thing we can talk to people about is, if you are keen to teach English as a foreign language, but you don't have the degree backup, talk to us about some of the destinations that would be a good match and where that piece of the puzzle won't be required in terms of preparing. So that's all great stuff. So just to recap on the degree, needed for certain countries. So be aware, if you don't have a degree, places like South Korea, Japan, Vietnam, they might not be ones for you. If you are graduating in 2020, then talk to your university or your college and find out, when is your certificate going to be issued? Because if you're going to a country that requires it, you need to make sure you have time for that. And then if you don't have a degree, essentially you don't have to worry about that piece, but just need to find a country that's suitable for you, somewhere like Cambodia or maybe a European country, and look at what the visa requirements are. But we can help with that, so that's all good. Okay, so another important thing about when you're teaching English is making sure you have a clean criminal record. And part of the application process will normally be to supply a police check or a background check or a police clearance certificate. And Sandra, talk us through, how do people obtain them? Do they need to be in date in a recent period? What's the process for that?
Yeah, it has to always be a recent police check when you apply for it, and you always need it. So there is no if. It's definitely something that you need. We have a little FAQ on our website as well. It's called How to Obtain a Police Background Check, and you can find the listing of all the countries with the links to the authorities that will issue it and the prices as well. I can just, if you want, I can just go over it here. We do, for example, recommend your background check with the FBI for US citizens, and that's about $18 at the moment. All the prices were updated at the beginning of the year, so they should be quite accurate at the moment, but with the situation worldwide at the moment, there might be extra charges for things, so that's not something that I'm aware of at the moment. Then for Canada, for example, it's the Royal Canadian Mounted Police. They will issue it and look after it for $25 Canadian. In the UK, we recommend ACRO, Criminal Records Office, and it's around £25. So it's all kind of in the same region. In Ireland and New Zealand, you are lucky because it can be obtained for free. And it's really easy. You just go to your local police station, and it's, as far as I know, it's actually issued the same day. And in Australia, it's the Australian Federal Police, and the charge is for $42. So like I said, you see, it's all about in the same price range. And I know that in South Africa, it's also with the federal government there that you have to apply for it. It takes quite a long time. So I heard of applicants waiting for about 8 weeks to get it. So it's really good to look into that as soon as you decide to apply for a job or an internship in any country.
Yeah, and I think that typically, I think we're probably all experiencing it across all our professional and our personal lives, that processes just take a bit longer now. Everything seems to take a little bit longer to process because less people are in offices with social distancing, and there's less people can actually go to physical offices. So the workload may be the same or increased in certain departments, but it just maybe takes an extra week or two for things to happen. So again, what Sandra says, as soon as you decide to apply, start looking into it. And then once you're engaged with an employer and you think that you may need to obtain your certificate of police clearance, then go ahead and get that done. It's not going to break the bank if you have to get another updated one by the time you actually travel. So it's just a good thing to have in place that you can be supplying with your job applications. Monty, for travel, I'm thinking about people who are planning to, you know, they're hoping to travel maybe in 2020 or early 21, okay? And then they could be abroad for 6 to 12 months. What considerations do people need to do with their passport?
You need to make sure that your passport is valid for the next 6 months after you travel. So that is very important. And obviously, if it's valid for a next few years, that's better. Because you never know what could happen. But at least 6 months, it has to be valid for from the date of traveling. And for Spain, with European people, there is not that much of a problem because obviously the traveling, well, not now because of COVID, but in a normal kind of life, traveling between European countries would be very easy and accessible. But obviously from people from visa countries, it's imperative because you cannot apply for your visa if you don't have the validity in your passport. So it is very important that you check your passport and the date on your passport before you travel.
Yes, true. I think for me personally, if I was looking to travel and I maybe only had something like 18 months left on my passport, I'd probably look into getting a renewal, because if I was to leave at the end of 2020 and maybe have a contract for 6 months but be open to staying longer, you really want to have sort of 6 months from the end of when you want to come back, because essentially if you want to travel and extend that, you just want to have that flexibility. And although it can be done to extend your passport, renew your passport validity from overseas, I know personally it becomes very expensive. For myself, I was in a situation where I was looking at renewing my passport, and in the country that I was currently in, I think it was like over 200 and something pounds or 200 and something euros to get that done, whereas it probably would have been 80 quid at home. So if you're abroad and you're trying to renew your passport, it can be much more expensive than if you do it at home and just get that preparation done and be ready for it. Sandra, thinking about in detail now, okay, when people are past the point of being accepted for a job and they have their paperwork, and we mentioned a little bit there about visa requirements and how sometimes a degree is a visa requirement, as well as other things like a police check, it could also be part of the visa. Your TEFL certificate could also be part of the visa process. There is another process that needs to happen, processes and processes, but there's another item that is required called legalization. And some people, if you've looked into TEFL, you might have seen that term, or you might have seen notarization, you might have seen apostille stamps. There's a lot of fancy words that are used in terms of this part. Will you break it down for us in real layman's terms so that people, the folks watching us at home, can understand what is legalization?
Rosie, that's a very good question. I'm laughing because it is indeed very complicated, and it's a complex process. So for Vietnam and for China, if you're applying for a work visa, you will need to get your documents legalized. Your documents will be your degree certificate that you need legalized, your police check, and your TEFL certificate. So these are the three items. It basically means that your documents receive an apostille stamp from the Foreign Commonwealth Office, and then it will be brought to the embassy of the country that you're going to, and there it will be attested. So it will have lovely little colorful stamps on it when it's done, and it will declare basically that it is a valid document. So it is a very complicated process. We are very, very happy that we looked into it a few years ago, and we are happy to assist and help So it's an external service that we're offering. We have an apostle service in the UK that we're working with, and we were able to secure a very good deal there for everyone who applies through us or done their certificate with us. So we're always happy to assist, and I would be passing on all the information, and I would be working with any applicant through the process. So the TEFL certificate is sent off to them. They will get it all done. They will go to the embassy and get all the stamps that it needs, and then it is directly sent out to whoever needs their certificate.
That's it. And it's tricky because your certificate needs to be authenticated in the country of issue. So so that's where it becomes a little bit complicated for people. And so why I'm so delighted that we can help people, because often we get that panicked phone call from a student or even sometimes from a partner to say, guys, we know you can help with this. Can you help this person through the legalization process? And working with the Hague Apostle at that discounted rate that we were able to secure has just been one of the most fantastic things we've been able to do, because visa rules and regulations change all the time. So when a new country just quickly says, okay, everything needs to be legalized, it's great to have an external legal partner that we can go to help people through that. So I'll give you a few examples and then you can tell me the answers, okay? What if I am from South Africa and I studied in South Africa and I'm living there now and I've done the Premier TEFL certificate? Does everything get legalized in the UK, or how does that work?
Yeah, so every document that you're talking about there, like your degree certificate, your police check and your TEFL certificate, need to be legalized in the country. So the TEFL certificate we will take care of, mm-hmm. for your police check and for your degree, you have to get in touch with the local authorities there and make sure that you use a service that is available in your country of origin.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And there are lots of companies just like the one that we partner with. I suppose the benefit is that at the time where things were changing in China and Vietnam, we were able to talk to a lot of different companies around the UK and make our best perfect match for a partnership. If you're in the US, for example, the authentication office might not be in your state. So you may be in the US and you may need to put your documents through the US. But if it requires an in-person interview, you may also need to research a legalization company and hire them to do your business for you. And sometimes it's actually just way cheaper than you taking the time off work, having to go there, get the appointment. And then sometimes you've got to go back and collect the documents. It's not done by postal service. So it's good to know that. And Monty, for Spain, if somebody's coming to Spain, you must even be in your home country when you apply for the visa, isn't that correct?
Correct, yes. The person who wishes to come over to Spain for work, if they need to apply for a visa, which is the case of, for example, USA, Australia, South Africa, you do need to be in your home country when you apply for that visa. Now, how does it work if you come into work? You need to have a contract before you actually apply, because it's in fact the company in Spain who has to apply for a work visa for you. So it's a long process that obviously needs to go through. Everyone that wishes to come has to go through, but you must not travel if you do not have that visa. The company that will offers you the contract will apply through the governmental authorities in Spain for that work visa. Once they have confirmation of that visa, then in your home country you can make all the arrangements in the government of your country to legalize that visa. So everything has to be done before you travel, unfortunately. If you travel and you don't have that visa, you will be asked to go back.
Mm. It's good to know, though, Monty. And there's not a whole lot of countries that are like that, but it's important to know that for people who are keen on staying, stay put at home, do your preparation, do your applications and wait until you get the job offer to go through the legal go through the job visa process to make sure you have everything before you go. Because I can imagine there will be people all over the world who are just itching to go somewhere, and we talk to them. I hear them on the phones all the time, and so I'm just making sure that people know, if you're watching this and Spain is your top destination, stick it out at home, get your paperwork done, including the visa application, before you start to plan the actual international travel.
Yeah, it's unfortunately, it's not the first time.
Yeah, it's important to know. Yeah. Okay, so aside from, now actually I'll recap this before we move on because there was a bit in that. We've talked about the application form and what questions to prepare yourself for. So start thinking about your personal motivation, start writing down why would you actually want to travel abroad and teach English, because that's really important. People who are recruiters and employers on the other side of the world reading this, they want to know that you're going to be dedicated to your job and that you are going to stick out your contract, that you're not just a sort of fly-by-night traveler trying a different career for a change. And also be prepared that in that application form, you might have to do your intro video. So you could start scripting some of the things that you might want to say. You could even do a bit of a dry run and do some recording, set up your camera. And so long as you have a decent phone, then that's going to give you all the quality that you need. That'd be perfect. We've talked about the importance of having your TEFL certification. And if you're thinking that TEFL is for you and that you want to get into this, before all of the things we're talking about today, you need to enroll in an accredited TEFL course so that you have a minimum of 120 hours of TEFL training before you start this journey. Otherwise, employers just simply won't take you seriously. Degree, we've talked about how there's opportunities for non-degree holders, but if you do want to go to a country where a degree is required as part of the visa process, it's important to check when you'll have your official certificate so that you won't delay your departure. We even talked about the importance of having access to a clean police record that's valid within, is it within 3 to 6 months? Sandra, what's the typical term?
It's different for a lot of countries, but 6 months is definitely a time frame that you should have in mind.
Okay, perfect. That's great for people.
The average there.
Yes, okay, super.
How long it's valid for.
And we've talked about how it's important to have lots of time left on the validity of your passport. And we've touched on then the legalization, which is tied to only a few countries at the minute, but it's also important for people to know that if you're looking to go to those certain countries, the Chinese embassy in the UK is not currently open today, but the Vietnamese one is. So we're on that all the time, and Sandra and her team are in touch with either people who are planning to go to those countries and then also with our partners in the UK, so that as soon as that those guys can process the paperwork, then we will be full steam ahead. Isn't that fair to say?
Yeah.
Okay, so we move on then. We've covered all of that piece of the topic for today. Now, in terms of other either documentation or preparation that people need to look at when they're planning to travel abroad, and this is no different, pre-COVID and then COVID times, a lot of this is all the same. So there's not a whole lot of extra work that you need to do to get prepared, but it's just that we want to talk about time scales of getting these things in place and little tweaks that you need to be aware of just to make sure that you are totally covered when you embark on this amazing journey. So the first thing I think we should talk about is travel insurance, the importance of it, what people should be looking for when they find a policy. Sandra, do you want to start us on that?
I can, yeah, of course. So yeah, once you've been accepted to one of our programs or even have applied for a job and have been successful, it's good to start thinking about insurance, definitely. So you will have, it's good to compare prices, obviously, prices and packages. You will need a very comprehensive travel insurance, and we always recommend that it includes medical expenses, personal belongings, personal injury and life cover and things like that. So it's good to put that all into the planning period after you've been accepted, when you start looking for flights as well and things like that. But it's a major thing that you will need.
Yeah, for sure. For me, it's a tandem thing. You book your flights and your insurance at exactly the same time to make sure that all that security is locked in together. Mm. And Mansi, in Spain, when people come and they're teaching English there and they have their correct visa to be employed in Spain, do they get access to free healthcare, or do they need to pay, or that it's all bundled in with their insurance anyway? We need to make sure that people have that kind of cover. But how does it work? Do they join in with the normal healthcare system?
Yeah, so obviously travel insurance is something that we highly recommend, but not so much on medical insurance, especially for Europeans, because what happens here is once you have contract, you are covered by social security in Spain, so you have access to all medical healthcare, hospitals. You have free access to everything once you have a contract, so you shouldn't worry really about any medical issues. But it's always good that you have something private, because in case there is something that you want to have, or that is not a serious issue, but you should be very, very relaxed that you will be covered by the social security here, so there's no issues with healthcare at all.
That's great. And say for vaccines, not such an issue in Europe, but for certainly people heading to either South America or Southeast Asia, Sandra, would you recommend a time period for people to be planning their vaccines prior to travel?
It's one thing that I would recommend to people in the same kind of period where you look into insurance and start looking to flights. Make an appointment with your doctor straight away and discuss where you're going to go and look at all the recommended vaccinations for the country and see if they apply to you. Your doctor knows your whole health history as well. And you advise you obviously the best. Obviously, most countries, like in everywhere in the world, you need that five shot tetanus, diphtheria. What is it, measles, mumps, and rubella is in it. So this one should be up to date, but that's the one that you should have on a regular basis anyway. And then some countries might recommend that you get a shot for hepatitis A, but that's all different for every country. But your doctor is definitely your best friend when it comes to vaccinations.
Absolutely. Couldn't agree more. And some vaccines will need around about 6 weeks to get active in your system. So don't leave it to the last minute. That's what I'd say, because otherwise, you know, essentially there's no point. If you get a vaccine 2 weeks before you travel, certain vaccines just won't have the time to give you immunity. And so by the time you travel, you know, you could still end up picking up something that you weren't planning to. So it's good to make sure, I suppose, 10 weeks out, make an appointment with your doctor, get the conversation had, and make sure you've got those shots by the 6 week period, I'd say.
Really as soon as possible, and then set up a schedule as well that you might have on your fridge in the kitchen.
Yeah, so that's it. And you know, some of them you can have a top up after a year or 2 years, and then it gives you a 10-year cover. So that can be a very cost effective, efficient way if you plan to stay traveling for quite a while. So that's good. Budget money. Money is an important topic to talk about. And we don't want anybody planning to go abroad with an empty pocket. So what's the formula for working out how much people need to save with them? Go on, Sandra.
Yeah, so our internships, for example, if we stick with that for a second there, you usually get an allowance, but that's paid after you've been there for a while and have been and teaching in the school for a while. So we recommend that you bring enough money to cover your first few weeks or more, even a couple of months. So say 5 to 8 weeks is good if you have enough spending money in your pocket. You arrive in a country that you've never been to, so you want to maybe do a little bit of touristy things. So definitely have that prepared in your mind as well. Then most Asian countries, I suppose that you can get food very cheap and very good and exotic food. But think of someone who has maybe dietary restrictions or needs a special diet. So that's something to budget for as well, because these things might be accessible in the country that you're traveling to, but they might be costly. So I think these are things to keep in mind as well. So definitely don't travel without any money in your pocket or access to credit cards maybe if you're in an emergency. So that's always good to plan for.
Tis, because for some of our programs, you might have a full 2-week orientation. before you get into the classroom, which means that your first paycheck won't come until 6 weeks after you arrive in country. So I suppose for any individual, look at your induction or your orientation period, which is typically unpaid, and then look at the first cycle of your pay, and that's usually sort of four weeks or a month. So I think that's great advice, 5 to 8 weeks of enough money to live in the country that you're going to. And there's a great website called Numbeo, and that will give you...
I love that one.
Yeah, it's great, isn't it? Gives you the cost of living in each country, and you can drill down into the different cities. So you can get a very accurate view of what lifestyle might, you know, a normal lifestyle might cost for that. And then you can work out with your calculator how much you want to save and bring with you. And I do think, just as a personal tip, having access to an emergency credit card or an emergency fund is always good. You might never need it, but it just gives you that security blanket when you're away, just to have as a backup. And for, say, the cost of living in Spain, Monse, people will think, you know, that it's quite a cost-effective place to live. Roughly, what would be the norm for a monthly living cost out there?
Okay, so I must say, first of all, as well, that looking from our internships perspective, the cost of living is not that bad at all. It's not high, because the good thing about our internships is that most of the schools where teachers go to live, they offer accommodation, which is included within the deal. So because they live with host family, so accommodation is included and meals are included, either in the family home or in the school where they have lunch. So in that respect, obviously, is a very big help for everybody, because there is not a high cost at all. Plus they get paid a not so bad salary. If you think that you don't have to pay for accommodation or meals, your salary is all for you. So all you have to plan is what you're going to spend on private things, like if you want to do some tourism, or if you want to, you know, just go shopping for a bit. So it's not bad at all. Even if you were not in a host family, we usually try to get cheap accommodation, like student apartments, which are shared. So we try to make life cost the most effective for people, and the lowest that we can try and get for them, which usually will be 200 to 250 euros per month. And then obviously they'll have to go and shop for their own groceries. But I will have to say supermarkets are fairly cheap here in Spain, so you can get your food very cheap. So that shouldn't be, you know, a high cost for people. The difference is living in main cities, like Barcelona is very expensive. It is an expensive city, so you must have a higher budget if you come into one of these places, if you are going to share apartment or you're going to hire your own. That will be much, much expensive than other places. But the majority of places are cheap enough to live. And like I said, our internships have very good options for people to live for free and get free meals.
Yes. It's such a wonderful experience for people. And please, I think, look, if somebody's coming from around the world to live in another country, you want to be able to say yes to everything. Everything that you want to say yes. If you're in Phnom Penh and somebody says, hey, let's go to Siem Reap and go to Angkor Wat at dawn and see the sunrise over the temples, you want to say, yeah, I'm in for that. If you're in Catalonia and somebody says, hey, let's go into Barcelona at the weekend and, you know, let's go get the best paella ever, and you want to say, yeah, I'm on for that. So if you're taking the opportunity, this incredible opportunity to move around the world to teach English, take budget with you, take savings with you, that you can maximize this experience and you can have that bucket list ticked off, you know, whether it's Great Wall of China, whether it's, you know, UNESCO heritage sites, whatever it is, have the money to be able to see the showcase of these countries that you're going to and the best things that are there. It's such a wonderful opportunity. Okay, so as borders start to open up, okay, and preparations can be made to travel, we start to look at flights then, okay? And I guess this is a really uncertain, this is one of the most uncertain parts of this jigsaw, isn't it? That flights at the minute, yes, we can book them. Yes, we can get prices and quotes and things like that. But there is the, the overhanging thing that it could change. Everything could change, okay? So I think mentally our advice is that when people are planning this, you need to still stay flexible. So when we're planning this, especially for the next few months, say between now and the end of 2020, I think that start dates are being planned for jobs and contracts and internships and intakes around the world and schools reopening. And people are planning for travel. And we see a lot of information coming out from the airlines as well about their plans for beginning air travel again and for what new steps will be needed at the airport and on board the aircraft too. And getting back to that flexibility, I think let's just say you're at home and you've applied for a TEFL job, you've gotten a start date offer of October, and you start looking at flights because everything is all falling into place. The one thing I would say is you need to book a flexible flight, or at least be talking to the airline to understand the full terms and conditions, the bits that people never read, about what happens if this flight gets delayed or cancelled or rescheduled, and understand your rights. It'll tie in with your insurance as well. But I think from my perspective, booking the flights is one of those things where you normally feel like something is set in stone when you're about to travel. And for me, that's when I really get excited, when I get that email confirmation that says your registration code, your booking code, and all the details, and you see that you're departing from the airport. I get really excited about that part. But we still need to remain flexible, isn't that right, Sandra? We need to remain open-minded about this, that it could shift forward a little bit, a couple of weeks, it could be a month. It all depends on how we're coping globally with the pandemic.
I totally agree, Rosie, and I think no company will offer a job if they don't actually have any rules and restrictions in place and know how to advise people as well. So wait until you get your placement confirmed, no matter if it's a job or an internship, and then start making your flight arrangements from there on, and definitely do a flexible flight. Also check what the conditions might be if the whole health situation flares up again, because we obviously don't know that. So I think from now on, airlines will have an eye on that as well and have rules for that in place as well.
Yeah, it's true. I mean, I know that if we book a flight at the minute, or we say if we had a flight booked at the minute, certainly within Europe and within Ireland, you're entitled to a cash refund. That's what the law is. And so, you know, if you were thinking about booking travel to go to your TEFL job destination, you might think to yourself, well, I'll just book a normal flight, and if things change, I'll be looked after. And that might be the case if the fault is with the airline or if it's new governmental rules. But something could happen to you personally where you need to change the flight too. And that's why I would say that the flexible flight gives everybody security, because you have the ability then to change that with little cost, you know, and you're not looking at a financial loss, which is important. Because we all want you to have as much money when you go abroad as possible.
The main thing with COVID now is that we all have to and need to adapt to different circumstances, because nothing is like it was before. Therefore, we need to think of all these changes. What could happen if COVID comes back again, if I cannot travel, if when I'm there I have to return home? So we need to adapt ourselves and be flexible, first of all.
Very true. It's great advice. It really is. And then if we think about it, so we've done the preparation piece. We thought about everything that we need to organise when we're applying. Then we thought about what we need to do whenever we're accepted, you know, in terms of the flights and the insurance and the vaccines and all those kind of things. And then we've just touched on, you know, if flights change and things like that. But let's get to the good bit now. Let's start thinking about, okay, what might be slightly different when we actually get abroad, you know, because that piece of actually landing in a foreign country, and the sights are different, the sounds are different, the smells are different, you hear different languages, you know. Again, for me, that's such an exciting time, you know, the air always feels warmer, well, warmer than Ireland anyway, and you're there in that foreign environment, you know, I just love that piece of the journey. But we do have to be aware that there's probably going to be some changes. So going through the airport and potentially, you touched on it, Sandra, quarantine. Have you heard of many countries saying that a quarantine might be necessary?
I know that they're discussing it for travel within Europe. So I'm very curious to find out about that as well. But so far, Thailand was the only country that really said that they're going to implement that. There haven't been any flights really going in and out unless it was absolutely necessary for people to travel. So we can't look back on experience on how that will go. But for if we stick with that example, for example, I know that our partners over there have set up the possibility for a 14-day quarantine in a hotel for everyone who comes over before orientation starts. So people need to be prepared to maybe when they look at start dates, for example, on our website, that they have to arrive 14 days before that date so they can actually do what they're told when they arrive in the country. Then there's talk of doing temperature checks, obviously, at the airport. I think that might actually become a very common thing everywhere in the world to do that. But yeah, I know that all the countries across the globe are working on it. And I actually hope that they're working on a solution internationally so that you don't have to second guess when you're traveling how it's going to be when you're on an airplane.
Well, if there's anyone to find it out, it's you, Sandra. You will have that information.
This is something actually that is just being confirmed in Spain. This week, the law just came in yesterday when anyone from overseas flies into Spain. Sorry, they have to go into a 14-day quarantine. So they haven't explained yet how they're going to do it, whether you have to go to a hotel that they will provide. Because obviously some people that might be traveling don't actually have a place to live. But it is certain that people will have to go into quarantine for 14 days. Now, in terms of internships, if that happens, we're looking in a way that we will have a host family for that person. Therefore, we're hoping within the law, they will be allowed to go into the host family house and just do the 14 days there. But that only means that obviously you have to come for 14 days maybe prior to starting work, because for them 14 days you won't be able to go out at all.
Mm-hmm. And doesn't that feed into that whole thing of preparation? Because if you're thinking about a September or mid-September start date, mm-hmm. in Spain, you've got to come back 2 weeks because you might have to do a quarantine, and then that pushes everything else back 2 weeks when you need to get all your paperwork in order. So It just shows how important this conversation is today for people who are thinking about traveling, so you can start to put all those building blocks in place and make sure that you have the time that you need and plenty of time to get organized, because I know Sandra loves people to be organized early. I think it's the German in you, Sandra, but you love people to be organized so that you de-stress everyone. You have this wonderful way of working with people so that they feel relaxed when they go abroad and there's no last minute rushing, which I love. It's a great job. One of my questions today was, do we think that demand for jobs will be high, but then also competition will be high because so many people will want to get a TEFL job whenever travel restrictions lift? What do you think, Sandra? Do you think that the competition will be super high and people should be preparing now to up their game, maybe teach English online or something?
I think that's actually a very, very good question. And that's what I would recommend people would do now. Get your experience teaching online for now, because now is the best time to start your TEFL course. Completed, and then maybe just jump into the cold water and try teaching online so you get a little bit of experience and get a feel for it. And I think it will make a difference when you're actually filling out applications again in the near future. You have to think or take into account that when the whole crisis started, March, April was the time where a lot of teachers that have been abroad or were in countries abroad traveled home and left. So all these schools that had all these teachers there to teach, they're gone. So when this whole thing opens up again in international travel, I think that's the thing that is holding it a little bit back at the moment, because the schools are opening, there's no doubt about that. But what is happening to international travel? I think when that opens, there will be a boom in applications, and people will want to travel, and opt your game now and do what you can to qualify and make the best of yourself as that you can at the moment. Absolutely. And you get everything that we talked about that you already can organized. So you have that done and can act very, very, very fast when it happens.
Good advice. Mons, for you in Spain, I know you've only recently been allowed to go outside, but do you see many native English speakers still around, or is that just a question you can't answer because you see nobody?
No, I haven't seen anybody. That is true. But I do often speak to people a lot on the phone. And yes, there is lots of native speakers in Spain anyway, because obviously they were here prior to COVID. Yeah. So what's happened is they've all kind of got stuck as well. Like, obviously nobody can go out, and now everyone is reinventing themselves. So this is one of the things to take into account as well, talking about competition, because yes, there is going to be lots of competition out there. Why? Because people are looking just different ways of doing things and living their life. People are losing their jobs, so therefore they are looking into different options. People who maybe used to live in England before, now they've lost their jobs and they suddenly think that they want to travel and do something different and start teaching. So there is going to be lots of people now that are going to go into teaching suddenly. So there is lots of native speakers already in Spain, and there is going to be. So competition is going to be high. That's why starting now with the training and doing some online classes if you can, just to get that little, you know, training and experience on doing so, is going to be very important in the future when everyone can start traveling again and everyone wants a different kind of life altogether.
And it's true. I've had so many personal messages, people saying to me, Rosie, I'm reinventing myself. That is the term, yes, that people are using, because COVID has provided time. It's provided people with an opportunity to reflect on their current life and their commute and all the things that make up their current lives. And then they're sort of sitting back and saying, you know, maybe I didn't intend for my life to look like this. And they're looking at other options. And TEFL is a great option for people who do want to reinvent themselves, because the lifestyle that it provides, the opportunities are global. You know, you're not hemmed into one area of one country. You really have a passport to work anywhere around the world if you're TEFL certified, which is just, it's incredible. I don't know any other qualification quite like it. And I think that it's a good tip. You know, there will be a heightened competition, in the sense that so many people are at home upskilling now. You know, I mean, the people that are watching this, even attending webinars like this is a form of upskilling, because you're researching other opportunities. And then so many people that I know, and lots of people in my family, are at home doing online courses in lots of different new areas of study. So I think the whole world is doing some kind of e-learning at the minute to either sort of keep themselves occupied, to explore a new opportunity, or else just to improve their employment chances. I remember just a few months ago talking to a girl in China who was in the lockdown at that point. And she was an early childhood studies teacher, and she was doing her TEFL course because she could boost her salary by up to an extra $1,000 a month by having that accredited TEFL certificate. And I nearly couldn't believe it myself, but she said, I know this is what salary I can obtain when I am finished this and schools reopen. So the opportunity there is just incredible for people. And it's exciting. It is very exciting. But it's a great tip to be able to say, teach a bit online, get some experience going, because it really does stand out on your CV. And there's so many companies now that you can choose to work for, and you can work for a few different platforms, and it can be done part-time or full-time. So there's great flexibility within that too. Super. And you can teach kids, adults, all sorts. Just great. So I think you know, this has been such a great discussion, and we're moving towards the end now. And how I'd like to close, if it's okay with you, ladies, is I'm wondering for people who are sitting at home watching this today or listening or something while they're exercising, whatever they're doing, what pro tips would you give for people who want to become a TEFL teacher and who want to be part of the call to the demand of English teachers post-COVID? What's your sort of go-to tip for them now to do and get ready to answer this demand?
Go on, Sandra.
I was just going to say that would be a little bit of a recap now towards the end of really get your certificate done, get your qualification going now. You have the time to study, and we're all here for you. We're still operating as normal. Check on your passport, get all your documents in order, make sure that it's all there when you need it, and that you can access everything as soon as possible.
Completely agree. Like, people have the time to do it now. So just get it booked now, start your course, get your TEFL certificate ready. And I would just say, don't just stay with that 120 hours and that's it. No, do more research, look into other specific training that you can do, like specialized courses, how to teach young learners, for example. This is very important if you want to come over, for example, to Spain and teach in a school, because the main classes that you're going to have are with young learners. So get your training on a specific and do your online classes, do your experience, and obviously start your research on that country that you want to travel to. And build up that sensation that when this is all over, you will have that trip and you will start that new life or that new experience.
Fantastic. Fantastic. And we do have packages greater than the 120 hours. So that's a great tip too, that you can add in extra specialist classes to your certifications and essentially get that extra knowledge, that deeper knowledge about teaching certain scenarios. And for people starting out, you're most typically going to either be teaching young learners, a business English class, or exam preparation. And we have everything to cover all that, so there's no worries there. Ladies, you have been fantastic guests, and you have provided expert insight into what can become overwhelming for applicants. And, you know, it's easy for me to see, but now it's easy for the world to see why our alumni find it so smooth a process when they're dealing with ladies like you, because you really just know your stuff and you take everybody by the hand, and it's just the most wonderful experience for them. So I'm proud and I'm delighted to be part of this, and I'm excited that we've been able to share this. Whether people decide to teach English through Premier TEFL or through another provider, having this information today, I hope, will give you insight into getting prepared so that you can be part of that movement, that whenever international travel restrictions lift, you can be those people that go abroad. And if you are, please let us know. Please let us know if this webinar has impacted your preparations, and you can contact us either on the website or on YouTube or wherever you get to see this video. But I'd love to hear whether we've helped you either take that step forward or make the leap abroad. So please stay in touch. And always, as always, during this webinar series, we always give a free gift. So I'm delighted today that we're giving away the 30-hour teaching IELTS preparation. And so all you need to do to claim that free gift is to go to the Premier TEFL website, premiertefl.com, find our IELTS preparation course, and then use the Teach IELTS, IELTS, Teach IELTS code to claim your free course, and it's all yours, absolutely free of charge. So this is the penultimate conversation in our webinar series in conjunction with Go Abroad. We hope that you have enjoyed it as much as we have, and stay with us, because we will also have more coming out, more live webinars coming on premiertefl.com. And actually a new course as well has recently been launched. It's a 10-hour webinar course in teaching methodologies, and the reviews are just raving about the tutor and the interactivity and the dynamic learning. So before you engage in a huge sort of 120-hour commitment, join our 10-hour course, come and meet our tutors, do some practical training on Zoom. I promise you will love it. Thank you.